Before we go for the second session of the day, which is going to be very interesting, there's a little bit of announcement for the school debate that we have. We have scheduled it at 12:30, and we would like to declare the topic of the debate. It's Chetan Bhagat or Amish Tripathi, who is better at telling India's stories? This is the topic of the debate. I would request all the students participating in the debate competition to kindly step out of the auditorium. Seema Rajpal would be there, my colleague Seema Rajpal. She will be guiding you on the rules and regulation. Just the 12 students who are participating in the debate may please step out of the auditorium for the detailing on the session. So time has come for the most interesting and most awaited session of the day. And I'm sure everybody of us knows who's the gentleman who's going to grace this session as the chief speaker. As Indians, we've always been hooked to Bollywood for its romances, comedies, actions, and potboilers. The lives of stars never fail to excite us. Their life of struggle, courage, and resilience, their fortunes and misfortunes are part of the Bollywood dream machine. But Kabir Bedi appears to be different, maybe because of his unique journey. The Sandokan man, who bedazzled in the bold and the beautiful, has told his tumultuous journey through his no-holds-barred autobiography, Bollywood, Hollywood, Stories I Must Tell, which was published in 2021. I have the pleasure of inviting onto the stage Mr. Kabir Bedi, the man who has retained his charm over generations of fans and followers. From Bollywood to James Bond, the list of movies that have had an impact on us remains endless. In 2010, the Italian government knighted him with the title of Cavalier, Italy's highest civilian honor, for his lifetime achievements as an actor. He has been a voting member of the Oscars Academy since 1982. I personally am a big fan, so I have no other word than to ask my colleague Kaveri to kindly honor him with a bouquet first.
So, as Kasturi said, we've been waiting to listen to you, and we have a packed hall. Thank you so much for all of you joining us. So, Kabir, I can call you that.
Please.
It's been such an amazing journey, but let's talk about your relationship with Odisha a little.
Right.
With, through Pratima.
Well, many links with Odisha, because firstly, I have the greatest respect for Dr. Samantha, because I know the amazing work he's doing for tribal children at the Kalinga Institute of Social Services. I know the Kalinga Institute of Technology, who gave me a doctorate as well. I did the voiceovers for some great Sony Lumia shows in Konark and Dholi, which talks about the history of Odisha. And of course, my first wife, Pratima, who became one of India's leading Odissi dancers, learned her craft and art from the great Guru Kehlucharan Mahapatra, who was a legend in his lifetime. And of course, last but not least, your wonderful Chief Minister, Naveen Patnaik, has been a friend of mine since college. And he was a remarkable human being who led a very, very different life before he chose to enter politics. And he was part of the New York jet set, and then he suddenly gave it all up to come into politics and is now India's longest serving chief minister. So I bow to Naveen's achievements.
Wonderful. So we've established your love for Odisha and your connection for it, with it. You know, there's so much to talk to you about, but let me begin with the idea of this young man who first stuns people in Bombay with almost nude back in Tughlaq for Alec Padamsi, who made you actually lift weights for it. And you said you would only lift weights if he lifted weights with you. The idea of you and Alec Padamsi lifting weights together is just too mind-boggling for me. But this idea, this young man who sort of stunned Bombay theatre, that was your real arrival, wasn't it?
In terms of the dramatic arts, yes.
Yeah.
Because, you know, acting was always a hobby in my life. And I acted in school where I won the Kendall Cup for Best Actor. I acted at St. Stephen's College in Delhi. And when I joined advertising in Bombay, I continued acting. And my great good fortune was that Alec Padamsi was my boss.
Yeah.
And he realized what I'd done as an actor and cast me in Tughlaq, Girish Karnad's first great play in English. And it led to, it just became one of the biggest theater hits. Because the opening image that Alec had of this production, which is not in the script, but Alec is always one of those people that has spectacular ideas, was that the play would begin with me standing on the stage with my back to the audience, looking absolutely naked. And so as the curtains parted and the lights came on, you saw this man standing back to the audience, completely naked. And the audience went, to see a naked man on stage was something extraordinary. It was a shock to their system. And mind you, we're talking about the 70s here, so it was even more of a shock to the system. And then the royal courtiers come, dress him, and then Tughlaq turns around and begins his opening oration to the crowds. That set the pace for making me known in Bombay, well, Mumbai in those days. And it led to everything else. Hmm. But it led to roles in Bollywood, it led to the Italians discovering me, it led to my success and stardom in Europe, which in turn led to many other things. But Kaveri, you know, if I look at my book today and I look at how people have received it, it's been received very well, I must say.
It's been translated into several
languages. It's been translated into Italian, into Hungarian, into Marathi, even the Hindi edition is out right now, Kahi and Kahi. What people seem to have got from the book is not just a tale of achievements, because that is interesting, but it doesn't directly impact people's lives. What it seems to have touched is the fact that there's a certain vulnerability to my writing. I've not been afraid to talk about my mistakes. And I think my mistakes are what, and I've made many mistakes. For all my successes, I've made many mistakes. I think the mistakes is what people relate to, because they can see, you fool, how could you make a decision like that? Or they could say, my God, I better watch that situation. I shouldn't make a mistake like that. So I think that my mistakes have defined my book as much as my triumphs. And this has been true of all stages of my life, whether about my love life, whether about my professional life, or whether about my successes or failures. It's also how I recovered from those mistakes that is also important for everyone in their lives. We all make mistakes. We all have huge setbacks. The question is, how do we recover from that? And my book is not written like, you know, a primer of how to achieve success in three easy steps.
How I did this, how I did that, yeah.
It's just told. People draw their own lessons from it. And the important thing here is that whatever lesson they draw from my book is straight out of my raw experience, my raw emotion, because I've shared the agony of the consequences of the decisions that I made, as well as the joys that I had along the way. See, everybody, I've had a very adventurous life. Now, everybody wants an adventurous life. Who doesn't want an adventurous life? But not everyone is willing to pay the price of an adventurous life, the uncertainty of it, the ups and downs of it. And this is an account of an adventurous life and all the dangers that accompany that adventure. So even if you want to find out how crazy people like me have lived my life, it would be of great interest to you, because it'll be an extension of your adventurous self had you taken that path less traveled. And therefore, I think it would be of interest to those who read my book.
And a lot of it perhaps is in your DNA. Your parents were the coolest people and the most adventurous, weren't they?
Well, they were more than adventurous. I mean, my parents, in a word, were students at Oxford. They met there. My mother was English. And yet she chose to marry my father and follow him back to India when all he promised her was that I'm going to fight the British and you will have to wait outside jails for me. But she believed in idealism. She believed, she loved her country, England, but she hated colonialism. And she said, I will fight colonialism with you. So they came back, and then my mother became part of Gandhi's nonviolent struggle. She was one of his handpicked satyagrahis for leading the demonstration in our hometown. My father was a communist and a rabble rouser and a terrific orator. Both of them spent time in jails. And after independence, they didn't follow the fruits of political gains. They each found their salvation in discovering religion in different ways. My father as a very original philosopher, descendant of Guru Baba Nanak. My mother as a Buddhist nun, and she went on to become the highest ranked Buddhist nun in the world in the Tibetan tradition. So these are extraordinary.
Called Dalai Lama.
The Dalai Lama used to call her Mamila.
Mamila.
There's a reason for that. Because when the Tibetan refugees came out from Tibet with the Dalai Lama in 1959, after the Chinese decided to try and take over Tibet, or took over Tibet, hundreds of thousands of refugees followed him across the Himalayas. And God knows how many hundreds of thousands perished because they couldn't take the usual routes across the Himalayas. They were guarded by the Chinese. They had to go through trackless routes, and God knows how many died. But over 100,000 reached India. And Pandit Nehru sent my mother to look after them at the Misamari refugee camp.
Right.
And because I would be there at the camp watching all this, and my sister Guli, we used to call her Mummy. So the refugees started calling her Mamila. Oh, La okay. is a term of respect, like okay. G, Mamila. So she became Mamila to a whole generation of Tibetan refugees. And then later, she actually set up an institution which trained the highest lamas of Tibet to speak English, because she said, these lamas do not need a vocation. They can't be sent to till land and build roads. They have a vocation. They're great teachers. All they need is the language. So from the school that she created, the Young Lamas Home School, a whole generation of Tibetan lamas went into the West. And virtually all the big monasteries set up in the 70s, 80s, and 90s in Europe and America were created by students of the Young Lamas Home School. Amazing. So she had a huge influence in the spread of Buddhism in the Western world. So there are many stories like this in my book. This is just the story of my parents. And the remarkable thing about my parents, since we're still talking about them, is the love, respect, and relationship they had with each other, even when divided by beliefs, even when divided by geography. The bond that existed between these two people from their days in Oxford to the end was just extraordinary. It's one of the most touching stories in my book. So I think my book is worth the price of it just to read that story.
No, a lot more. The struggles you've had with handling people with mental health issues, yeah. I mean, I found that the most remarkable, not just, of course, with Parveen Babi, but your son, which I cannot imagine how you wrote that. It must have been the hardest thing you did. But those experiences are so raw. It's almost as if you're writing it, you know, you wrote it then. It reads so raw. Talk a bit about those.
You know, my book is sort of divided into various chapters. You can read it in any order you like.
Yeah.
Because it's written that each chapter is a story unto itself. So one of the stories that I've written is about my relationship with Parveen Babi, which coincided actually with the time of my great success in Europe. And while she was going through a mental breakdown, so that was one thing, and then all that followed from there. And the other story was the story of my son, who was a brilliant young man, graduate of Carnegie Mellon University, the mecca of infotech, who was struck down with schizophrenia at the age of 25 after graduating. And so it's tragic enough when anyone gets schizophrenia, but when that child is so brilliant and with such promise of the world to come and the dawn of the internet age at that time.
He probably would have been heading one of these.
Could have been. Yeah. He had the capacity.
One of these companies.
So the struggle to try and have him cured, have him brought back to a normal life, and above all, my struggle, and this is what the story is based on, it's based on the last 3 months when he realized what his diagnosis was, and he started talking about committing suicide, and how for 3 months I tried to prevent him from committing suicide, because this was an epic battle of trying to give somebody hope who had lost hope, who had every prospect in the world, and yet didn't believe in it. So I have dealt with mental issues with people that I've loved in great depth, and I've shared that journey in two stories in my book because I think it relates to many.
Yeah.
Because even many people here may not suffer from these maladies, but they will know of somebody that does, or some family that is looking after people who have schizophrenia or bipolar conditions or other mental conditions. And I think it's important to know that the suffering is not only those who are afflicted with these.
The entire family.
The entire family. Because the family sees this child, this boy, this woman that they love. But that person is no longer the same.
Yeah.
Something has changed in them in ways they cannot understand. And they keep trying to adjust for it. And it is equally, perhaps more difficult for the families and the caregivers than for the afflicted person himself. So those dilemmas are things that I've explored in my book because I think those are things that relate to my life, but also relate to yours or people that you know or people that you care about. And hopefully it will shape your attitude towards those who are afflicted with such problems because it's not just saying, "Woh toh ladka pagal ho gaya." It's not that simple. These are very complex, sensitive human issues, and we must all give it the understanding and respect it deserves.
Let's talk about something happy.
Okay, let's talk about things happy.
Your remarkable, remarkable successes in opening doors for Indians now. I mean, it's difficult even now, but I cannot imagine 1977, Sandokan, 1983, Octopussy. How many of you have seen it? I think almost everybody must have.
Yeah.
It was such an iconic moment for Indians, you know, to have you as James Bond's villain, arch enemy. What were those experiences like at a time when, having brown people was virtually something that
this
one
was,
heard of?
This was one of the biggest battles I faced in Hollywood, was the fact that they weren't writing roles for people from Asia or foreigners.
Not even blacks at that point.
Correct, not even for blacks. It's just not even for foreigners in general. I was extremely fortunate that the role I was asked to play for the Italians was the role of an Asian pirate.
Yeah.
And therefore, I became this romantic, glamorous pirate who fell in love with this English girl for the Italians. And that success gave me a lot of strength throughout my career. Gave me the strength to move on to Hollywood. There are other reasons for that too, but I don't have time to explain it all. But when I shot the Bond film, it was, so Sandokan was a great success in Europe. The Bond film, let me tell you the high point of the Bond film for me. They shot a good part of it in Udaipur.
Yeah.
And here I was, an Indian actor, living in the Shiv Nivas in Udaipur, in these beautiful suites with Roger Moore on my left and John Glenn, the director, next to me, and the Broccoli family, the producers there, and Louis Jordan, etc. And we're looking down on the Lake Palace in Udaipur, and it's evening, and the sound of the birds is there. And I'm thinking to myself, have I died and gone to heaven? This is...
And the Bond girls. There were
and the Bond girls. And the Bond girls. The Bond girls were living separately, but we saw them often enough. But I thought, it was like I died and gone to heaven. An Indian actor in Udaipur, overlooking the Lake Palace with the Bond team.
Playing a Sikh.
Playing a Sikh, which is what I am.
Yeah.
So it was really extraordinary. And then what happens is, and this is what I discovered, when you become part of a big franchise, and the Bond film is the oldest film franchise in the world and one of the most successful.
Before Marvel indeed.
Yeah, long before any other franchise. You become part of a kind of ecosystem.
Right.
Which is an ecosystem of fan clubs, conventions, symposiums, events around the world with fans, where they invite you, honor you, celebrate you, and write to you in their thousands. So this was my first experience of real global stardom.
Right.
The next came, of course, when I was part of the Bold and the Beautiful for 1 year. And that was a show watched by a billion people. So that, again, was the second wave in the 90s of understanding what global stardom means, because letters from every country in the world come to you. And people around the world have seen you. And unlike America, where shows like Bold and the Beautiful are seen as afternoon shows, in the rest of the world, including India, they're prime time shows at night. So these were seminal events for an Indian actor who went from Bollywood and made a career abroad, not only in Europe, but in America as well. And I must say, it was a heady feeling, but it's not a simple road. It's not a simple road because the biggest obstacles I mentioned in the beginning is they were not writing roles for foreigners. And so I had to follow a slightly different thing. I said, okay, they're not writing roles for Asians. I will play any foreigner. So I played Italians, I played South Americans, I played Russians, I played Germans. I played a variety of different nationalities because fortunately I could. And that helped me get through the problem of people not writing enough roles. Those are certainly among the problems. But you know, you advertise this session as Bollywood Hollywood, stories I must tell. So people probably have come here probably expecting a lot of Hollywood and Bollywood stories.
Please, go ahead. So, what are the fun things that you can tell us about? Bollywood, of course, for us, you will always be the horrible Khoon Bari Maang.
Khoon Bari Maang.
A horrible man you played.
I'm glad I convinced you. That's what I was paid to do. But you know, speaking of Khoon Bari Maang, I was actually living in Hollywood in those days. I was shooting a series with Tom Selleck, called Magnum P.I. In Hawaii.
Wow.
And I was sitting in my hotel room in Honolulu, looking out of this sea, and the sun was setting, and this golden light was reflecting off the sea. I think, what a lovely evening it is. And the phone rings. And those days were only landlines. Yeah. So I pick it up, and it's Rakesh Roshan calling from India. And I knew Rakesh from before. I said, Kabir, I've got a film for you. I want you to be the hero of my film. I said, what's the matter, Gudu? Have all the stars in Bollywood gone on strike that you're calling me in Honolulu to play a hero? He said, no, Kabir, thing is, the hero in my film becomes the villain. And no hero is willing to play this role. So I said, okay, thank you. It's a left-handed compliment, but yes, I'll take that. He said, the other thing is, if I put a villain in the role, there's no surprise.
Yeah.
So you're the only man who's got this image. You could be a hero, you could be a villain, you could be anything. I need you. I thought, well, okay, who's the heroine? He said, Rekha. I said, done. Done.
I mean, that's a no-brainer. Who would
because
not
Rekha
be
at that time, she'd done Umrao Jaan, she'd won national awards. She was the height of her powers as an actress. So for me, to come back to India and be paired with Rekha
yeah.
in Khun Marimang was a great and wonderful opportunity, and it certainly proved to be my biggest Bollywood hit
yeah.
To date. And I've got to be grateful to him for that. So that was one of my Hollywood-Bollywood stories. The other thing I must tell you is I did three films with Omar Sharif. The first was a film called Ashanti, with Michael Caine and me in the lead, which I shot in the late 70s. And then a couple of years later, I shot a miniseries called Red Eagle with Omar Sharif and Timothy Dalton. And then I shot, towards the end of the 80s, another series called Beyond Justice with Rutger Hauer and Omar Sharif. So Omar Sharif became like a friend of mine. I got to know him well. And we had this strange relationship where we'd take each other's roles. So when I was shooting the Bond film was supposed to finish by Christmas. And I had signed a miniseries called The Far Pavilions, which was Home Box Office's first miniseries ever. And it was based on this novel of MMK, a kind of colonial novel about this British Army officer who grows up in India, falls in love with an Indian princess, etc. And I played the role of Kodadad, the master of the horse, who brings up this little boy when he thinks he's an Indian. He doesn't realize he's English at that time. So I was master of the horse, and they signed me for that role. And as bad fortune would have it, the Bond film overshot. They couldn't finish in time. And they would not let me go in time for the series. And I begged the producers of Far and said, please delay it for a week. He said, I can't. On January 10th, a procession begins in Jaipur, where you are leading the parade of horses and elephants, and journalists from around the world are coming, and I cannot delay that. So he went and signed Omar Sharif for it. Then when it came to Ashanti, the role that I played, which is a co-equal role with Michael Caine, Omar Sharif was actually signed for that film. But they decided to shoot in Israel. Oh. I said, I'm an Egyptian actor, they'll kill me if I shoot in Israel.
Absolutely.
So I got signed for that role. So we did this a couple of times in my life. But Omar also had a particular quirk. When we were shooting on location, he ate very little. He'd have some coffee, some cashew nuts, etc. In the day, he was not interested in eating. His big thing was the evening meal. So evening meal meant he'd go to the chef in the kitchen, design a table for 6 or 8 people, wonderful menu, and then come to the set, and then he'd decide who he wants to call for dinner. He says,
right.
Kaveri, join me for dinner this evening.
Wow.
Kabir, join me for
Wouldn't
this dinner.
I love it.
Everybody loves it. So he'd make this wonderful table of 6 or 8 people. He was a very intelligent man, Omar Sharif, but also very easily bored. So if the conversation on the table was interesting, he'd be active, he'd be participating, etc. If the conversation became boring, then he would look for a fight. He'd wait to see somebody who says something. He'd say something and somebody say, some American actor say, well, Omar, that's your opinion. And he would go for her. What do you mean, my opinion? You aggress me when you say this. You think I have an opinion? I know. What do you know? And this fight would start. And this evening, every time ended up either with a guest leaving the table in tears or with Omar banging down the plate or napkin and walking off the table. This was his regular pattern. Because he didn't like being bored. And this was his way of getting excitement.
I suppose when you are in Lawrence of Arabia, you know, it can only go downhill from there.
No. Omar was one of my role models.
Yeah.
Because he was one of the people from the, I regard it as the East.
Absolutely.
Who would actually become a major star in Hollywood.
Star.
And I had
yeah.
the greatest respect for Omar.
Right.
And he was a bit of a wild card. He had his tempers. We had our fights too. But eventually, he was a great friend. And I missed him deeply when he passed away.
Yeah. But what a magnificent career you've had, Kabir. When you look back, do you think there was one, I mean, apart from Sandokan, of course, which was so iconic, was there, and Bond, any one role that you really, really loved and you thought that was really you?
You know, I have played Shah Jahan on stage and on screen.
Screen both.
The screen version, I unfortunately, didn't do well out here. But I really loved the role that I played. And when I played him on stage, this was in Canada at the Luminato Theatre Festival, which is one of the foremost performing arts venues in the world. It was done with an operatic scale. And we had 12 dancers from Kumudni Lakhia's Institute of Dance here come there. And they made it into a kind of dance drama. So when Shah Jahan is imprisoned in the Red Fort, where he can see the Taj Mahal, but is not allowed to go to it, and he's imprisoned with his daughter, Jahanara, which is played by Lisa Ray, and it's like King Lear talking to the elements and talking to his daughters. When he talks to her about the coming of the Mughals, etc., these dancers come on, and you hear the horse beats.
Right.
And it was very audiovisual. And then his dreams of how he built the Taj Mahal, his love for Mumtaz, all that. It was, and I was on stage for 90 minutes nonstop talking. And I really loved playing the role of Shah Jahan, both on stage and on screen. Unfortunately, it's not been seen much on screen here, but on stage it got some phenomenal reviews in Canada. And I felt very close to Shah Jahan. In fact, I've done the voices of Shah Jahan in many Sony Lumiere's also, at the Red Fort in Delhi, in Nishat Bagh in Pakistan, in Srinagar, and I have had a great feeling for Shah Jahan, because when I grew up as a child, I would see the Red Fort or the Jama Masjid in Delhi, and I always felt blown away by Shah Jahan. And in fact, I wanted to become an architect. That was a career I wanted to follow. Unfortunately, as you'll see from my book, many factors in the family's economic, they had no money, basically. I couldn't afford to go to study architecture. And so I studied history at St. Stephen's so that I could work in All India Radio at the same time to pay for my college. And that itself led to the interview with the Beatles.
The famous Beatles interview,
and many
which
other
I hope you all know was erased and recorded over, which is a story in itself. Two quick questions, then, quickly. Please. Yeah, go ahead.
Kabirji, my question is, you have been Kabir the theater artist, Kabir the Bollywood artist, the Hollywood artist, Kabir the television artist. Have you thought of Kabir as a politician like your close friend Naveen ji?
I'll leave that to Naveen. You know, it's not that I wasn't interested in politics, because my family fought for the country's freedom, and I was very idealistic about what I wanted for India, and I believed in India, but I was never rich enough to be a politician. And I realized that if I entered politics to make money, then the whole point of my entering politics was negated. So I never had the money to enter politics. I had the interest. But then, by the same token, my career as an actor took me out of India. I've been out of India for over 25 years. Between Italy and Hollywood and England. Over 25 years have been spent abroad. And so the politics of the country has always interested me, but I've never been able to participate in it as a politician. I have been part of debates on television. I have been part of the discussions that we have on the way India should go and where and what is happening. So, politics of interest to me, but not as a profession. I'll leave that to people who are willing to give their lives to it in a different kind of way.
I hope you know that Kabir is one of the few people who actually lost money on Apple. He lost a fortune.
Yes.
That he'd invested and at a time when Apple shares were declining. I
invested in Apple when it was $2, believing in the future of the company. And what I learned in the stock market is that you can be right in the long term, but dead in the short term. Because in the short term, it went down to $1, and I'd leveraged my bets, so I lost even more. So, you know, the story of my financial reverse is also part of my part of my book. In fact, between the death of my son, the suicide of my son, which devastated me and left me incapable of working for a period of time, and the financial mistakes that I had made, and the investments that I truly believed were bulletproof investments, and I invested heavily in them, and I lost them all. So, financial disaster, emotional catastrophe, all these things hit me at the same time. And that's why I left Hollywood. And how I rebuilt my career is also the final chapter of the book. So the lesson essentially here is we all make mistakes, but we can all recover from mistakes if we go back to the strengths that made us a success in the first place. Because that is all inside us. If you've had any degree of success, it's because you did that. And in your darkest moments, spend your time mourning that moment. It's important to mourn it. Say, yes, I screwed up. I made mistakes. Disasters happened to me. How do I rise from this? Because moping about it and blaming yourself about it is not going to solve the problem. You have to find ways of rising. And the only way of doing that is to remind yourself of the strengths within you and of the people in your life who gave you strength. Whether it's your parents, whether it's your guru, whether it's your teachers, people that saw something in you, inspired you, and brought you to be your best. Those are the things that give you the strength to live life again and make it a success again.
That's why I think your memoir is a tremendous act of courage as well, because it takes enormous courage to actually bear your soul to the world and tell them that this is who I am.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
Last question, yes.
Before we get to the last question, I want to take this advantage of presenting you a copy of my book, Kaveri.
I have it, but thank you very much. Last question. Yes, please.
How are you seeing the current status of Hollywood now when compared to US time? And the way South movies are performing with the content, with the creativity.
So could you repeat your question, please?
So how are you seeing the current status of Bollywood now? When compared to yesteryears and the way the South movies are performing with the content and the creativity?
See, Bollywood is Bollywood. It is one of the most vibrant industries. It's had a spate of some bad films right now. The South have had a spate of some good films right now. That could change tomorrow. The question today is not so much Bollywood versus the South or Bollywood versus Western films. Our whole business is going through the most profound transformation that it has seen in the last 15, 20 years. Because during this pandemic, and perhaps also because of it, the streaming services like Netflix, Amazon, Disney, Sony Live, all these companies that have come up, they have become the de facto means of distribution. People have almost started losing their habit of going to the cinema because abhi aa jayegi online mein do teen mahine mein aa jayegi kya jaane ka, and it's expensive to go out. So unless it's a big event film where you want to see and feel the whole experience of this film, that kind of film will draw people to theaters. But whether it's Bollywood or the South, the problem these industries are facing is how do you deal with the new masters of distribution, which is the streaming services. And how do you, which films do you choose to make for cinema? Because not all films are going to work for cinema like they did in the past, because earlier cinema was the only way you saw it, or you had to wait months and months for television. Today you can see it within weeks or literally a month on streaming services. So how does Bollywood and the South, and for that matter even films from Hollywood, deal with this new phenomenon that has happened, that has changed the nature of the business completely? Those are the challenges far more important. Bollywood will still create some great films. The South will still create some great films. You know, we always think that the golden age of cinema has passed. Look at those films they used to make in those days. True, but we remember only the good films. You don't remember the bad films that were making then. Today also, we look at all the bad films and we ignore the few good films made. 10 years from now, you'll be quoting the best films of today, saying what films they made then. So, cinema will always reinvent itself because we have dreams. We have dreams, and we want to market our dreams. We want to share our dreams. We want to create worlds around our dreams. And there'll always be dreamers. There'll always be filmmakers. And whether they distribute through streaming services or theaters or any other medium, the fact is, people love cinema, and they'll find ways of watching it. And each cinema will rise to the challenge of the new environment in different ways. And I wish them the best, because this industry has given me a wonderful life, sometimes a very painful life. But on the balance, it's given me a very wonderful life. And I've seen this business on three continents for many decades. And the names change, the game remains the same, because ultimately it's about creating good films with great talent and great directors and great people that contribute their skills, whether as musicians or cinematographers, makeup people, editors, to create a work of art that lives and endures, makes you laugh, makes you cry, makes you think, gives you a film to remember for all time.
But can you imagine Sandokan as a series now in this world of streaming? My God, it would be a super hit, right?
Yeah, yeah.
All over the world.
Well, it was...
We should petition them to re-release it on Netflix or whatever.
You know, in Italy, they never stopped releasing it because they kept showing it all the time.
All the time, yeah.
But they never had a good English dub on it. They kept it as a European phenomenon. And it has worked wonderfully in Europe and the Spanish-speaking countries of South America. And those have been its strongest markets. It will find a market eventually on the streaming services too, I'm sure.
I'm sure.
But
we'll relive those golden days.
Sandokan was one of those phenomenon that had viewership numbers that are not equal till today. They had what's called a 32% share, which is unheard of today. Today, if you get a 5% share, you think it's fantastic. 27 million people out of 60 million people in the country were glued to their television sets. That is an extraordinary figure for television. And that's why I've had this enduring relationship with Italy. I've since then done six other series in Italy. The most recent in 2010 with Lino Banfi. But the root of all that, what gave me the strength to all that and the popularity to do all that was the original Sandokan series. So that was certainly a series that changed my life. But also, since then, I have regarded myself as the unofficial ambassador between Italy and India, promoting India in Italy and Italy in India. And one of the charities that I support is called Care and Share Italia, which raises money in Italy for children from the slums, picked out of the slums in Hyderabad and Telangana, and then educates them from kindergarten to university, wow, looking after all their expenses. Because Italians care, they care.
Wonderful. We could, of course, go on forever, but...
I have a question, if I have please, your permission. Please. Just the last... I should have the liberty to ask
Of course,
it.
Of course.
I'm asking this question. I did not intend to, but I'm asking this after hearing you live. What an amazing voice you have. Have you engineered it to that, or, you know, you always had it?
This gentleman sitting here also talked to me about my voice. Let me say that... My voice has not been unappreciated. It has been used in a number of Sony Lumiere shows, including here at Konark and Dhauli, but all over India. I do a lot of work on advertising. I do a lot of work on documentaries. And people, even in cinema, always talk about my voice. So I'm grateful that my voice is recognized. The gift of the voice comes from my parents. But certainly, as an actor, I've learned how to develop it, how to project it, how to give it many tones, depending on what's needed. And I've worked on my voice, but the basic voice, I must thank the universe and my parents for giving me such a wonderful voice.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. So we come to the conclusion of this session. Before we mark it the end of the session, may I please request the New Indian Express editorial director to kindly come up on the stage. Sir, Prabhu Chawla ji, to please come up on the stage.
I also want to mention that the Hindi edition of my book, Kahi and Kahi, has also been released. So those of you who like to read it in Hindi, please do read it in Hindi. How lovely to see you, Prabhu. How lovely to see you. This is one of my favorite men in journalism. He's so wonderful. That
Can
is part of
picture?
Your charm. Thank you so much, Prabhu. I'm most honored.
Thank you, sir.